So let us start with the session 3 of day 2 of the online faculty development program on advanced construction technology being organized by the Department of Civil Engineering, Gyan Nijal Singh Campus College of Engineering and Technology, MRSPTU, Bathinda, Punjab. So the expert for this session is with us, and I also welcome all the participants. So let me take the privilege to introduce our expert. So Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Agarwal ji, an acknowledged academician and administrator, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Agarwal has to his credit on excellent and meritorious academic career throughout. He has obtained all his professional education from prestigious technological institutions of the country. He obtained his Bachelor of Engineering degree in Civil Engineering with distinction from Thapar Institute of Engineering and Technology, Patiala, in 1990. He followed it up with the Master's of Engineering degree in Highway Engineering with distinction from Punjab Engineering College, Chandigarh, which is known as PEC Chandigarh, with GATE Fellowship in 1992. While in service, he got MHRD's QIP Fellowship to earn his PhD degree in Transportation Engineering from Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, in 2003. He has a long and illustrious service career of serving at Gyan Nijal Singh Campus College of Engineering and Technology, Bathinda, in various capacities since last 29 years. He has headed the Department of Civil Engineering, Department of Training and Placement, and Academics Department at this college during this period. He has also served as Director, Punjab Institute of Technology, GTBgarh, Moga, Punjab. Apart from discharging his duties as Professor of Civil Engineering, at present, he is also serving as Dean of Distance Education Program and Director of Construction Wing of Maharaja Ranjit Singh Punjab Technical University, Bathinda. He has participated in more than 50 national and international level conferences, seminars, workshops, and professional meetings in India and abroad, and published more than 75 technical or research papers in various journals and conference proceedings. He has guided more than 50 postgraduate students for completing their master's dissertation and 4 doctoral students for completing their PhD thesis. He also traveled abroad to present his research work at various international platforms like World Roads Congress Paris, France, University of Birmingham, UK, Nanyang Technological University, Singapore, and Australian Road Research Board, Melbourne, Australia. He is an active member of the various international and national professional organizations such as ASCE, PIARC, REAAA, IRC, IEI, ISTE, IIBE, and IUT, etc. He has been honored with several awards such as Vikas Ratna Award, Bharat Jyoti Award, and Siksha Ratna Award for his contribution to the society through his profession. He has been actively engaged in providing technical consultancy to several government and private organizations in the field of highways, railways, and airport engineering. He is also coordinating the state technical agency set up by the Union Ministry of Rural Development for implementation of prestigious PMGSY Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana in the state of Punjab. He is an expert panel of several academic and technological organizations of the country for enriching and sharing his valuable experience gained over several years. So we welcome, sir, and with your huge knowledge, please, I request you to please proceed with the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sukhdeep and Kundan, for introducing me to the audience. As you can see, around 39 participants have joined. How many participants are participating in the session?
Sir, total participants are 109, but 48 are there right now, sir.
48 are there right now. Okay, I hope since this being a post-lunch session, so people might not have just come back from their lunch. So it's always the case in most of the FDPs that the post-lunch session is always very difficult to attend, not only for the participants, even for the presenters as well. So anyhow, I would request the participants to bear with me for about hour and 15 minutes, and whereby I would like to share some of, not exactly my experiences, but as the title of this FDP goes, that some new technologies in the field of civil engineering are to be discussed. So since, as Sudeep has mentioned in my intro, that I mostly specialize in the area of transportation engineering, and they are doing highway engineering. So that is why I have chosen this topic to talk to you regarding what are the, you can say, the some of the developments which have taken place during last, say, one decade or so in the field of the road construction technology. I mean, what sort of changes have taken up from the conventional way of constructing the bituminous roads these concrete roads. So I will be deliberating upon that. So before going into that proceeding, let me be very thankful to the organizers of this FDP for giving me this opportunity to give me a presentation on this in topic today. And I also extend a very warm welcome to all the participants who are present online mode in various parts of the country. So very warm welcome to all of you. So let me start with my presentation. Okay, is the screen visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay.
You can open in presentation mode,
sir. Okay, so the participants, as you can see, that the title of my presentation is New Construction Technologies for Highways. And why new? I mean, I can't say that these are the very recent ones, but new means how they are different from the conventional ones. So what are the conventional construction technology for highways, different kinds of highways, and what changes have taken place during, you can say, last one decade, two decades in that. So that will be the topic of my discussion. So before going into the details of the road construction, let me briefly introduce to you about the Indian highway network. I suppose majority of the participants are from civil engineering background, Sudeep.
Yes, sir.
Civil engineering. Do we have the interdisciplinary candidates as well?
No, sir. Only from civil engineering and environmental.
Only from civil engineering. That's fine. So it means since all are civil engineers, they might have gone through the subject of transportation engineering. So that is why I may not be required to, explain some technical terms, if at all it is required. Okay. So in case there are some typical terms, that I will be explaining. Fine. So that I can take that much of liberty since most of you are from civil engineering field. Okay. So let us talk about the Indian highway network first. So this you understand that road construction has always been a focus area in India, not only in the post-independence era, but even the pre-independence era. In the pre-independence era, as you know that the British people, they had constructed a lot of roads all over the country. And even our the road development plan, the first road development plan of our country, which we call as the Nagpur Road Plan, that was envisaged and started well before the independence. That was in the year 1943. So 4 years before India got independence, that first road development plan that already started. It means the British people, they were paying a lot of attention for the development of roads in the country. And but thereafter, in the post-independence era, the construction of roads have significantly increased in the recent years. There is a you can say a small reason behind it. I think some of the participants, the younger ones may not be knowing, but compared to being the middle age, they might be knowing that India got open up for the world trade in the year 1990s. So that was the time when many of the multinational companies, they started visiting our country. And but their common complaint was that the road infrastructure in our country was not good. So that is why the government of India thought that in order to attract more these multinational companies and to have more FDI, foreign direct investment, we need to develop our this road infrastructure, and we should bring it to the level of the Western world. So that was the, I think, in the early 90s that the government decided to bring a sea change in how the roads are constructed, built, and managed in our country. So presently, the India Road Network have total road length of 62 lakh kilometers, which is the second largest road network in the world after USA. Now, this road network incorporates around 2100 kilometer expressways, which are access controlled highways, and then 1.4 lakh kilometer national highways, and 1.8 lakh kilometers of state highways. So the remaining ones are from the other categories of roads, which makes it the total of around 62 lakh kilometer of the total road network in our country. So as I mentioned earlier, the road sector received a major impetus with the launch of the National Highway Development Project, which we call as the NHDP project, and which comprised of GQ, that is Golden Quadrilateral, connecting the four major metros of the country. Then East-West Corridor and North-South Corridor in the year 1998. Also looking into the necessities of the rural people, another Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, was initiated in the year 2000. And incidentally, as Sudhi mentioned, that I am also coordinating this scheme in our state of Punjab as a state technical agency. So I'm giving my inputs for the such type of road construction in the state of Punjab to the government of India through their Ministry of Rural Development. Now, then with an aim to improve connectivity, especially along the economic corridor, border region, and far-flung areas, another government scheme has been launched recently in the year 2017, which we call as the Bharatmala Pariyojana. So it means a lot of the road construction activities are going on all over the country. And it is, after 2011 onwards, that the road construction, you can say, pace has really taken up. Now, if you talk about the type of the roads, the category of the roads, or specifically the pavements which we are constructing, and where we would like to apply our technologies or the new technologies for construction. So mainly two types of pavements are designed and constructed all over the world. Flexible payments and rigid payments, you might be knowing. Now, out of the total paved road length in India, now this is a very surprising kind of a figure. The flexible payments or bituminous payments, they comprise 98% of them. Whereas the rigid payments or cement concrete payments are just about 2%. So there is a lot of disparity between the construction of the flexible as the rigid payments in our country. There are certain reasons for that. I'll be deliberating those reasons in my next slide. So on the left hand side, you can just see the structure of a flexible payment. And on the right hand side, you can see the structure of a rigid payment. As you can see, the flexible payment is a layered payment. Number of layers are there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so many number of layers are there in case of this flexible payment. But in case of rigid payment, which just comprises of a subbase course overlaid with a cement concrete slab. So even the code says that in case you do not want to provide even this layer of base or subbase, you can directly lay the poured and cement concrete. But otherwise, from the practical point of view, that is not very much advisable. So my discussion in this presentation will be focused on the layered construction in case of flexible payment and the concrete slab in case of the rigid payments. Now, this slide shows some of the, you can say, key differences between the flexible and the rigid payments. And as I mentioned that flexible payment, a series of layers, whereas a rigid payment, just one layer. And then another important one is the number four payment design is influenced by the subgrade strength. So here in case flexible payment, what is the strength of the soil? That is very much important. Whereas in case of rigid payment, what is the strength of the concrete, rather the flexural strength of concrete, that is far more important. Okay. So these are two very distinctive type of payments where their design is totally different, their way of method of construction is totally different, and even their you can say the way they are maintained or managed throughout their lifetime, that is also totally different. And it has been observed very, you can say, through so many studies that the flexible payments, they may be a little, you can say, economical to construct in the beginning, but their maintenance cost is huge. Whereas on the other hand, the rigid payment, they may be slightly costlier to construct in the beginning, but their maintenance cost is almost very minimal or near to, you can say, zero over a period of, say, 5 to 10 years. And it can last for a much longer period of time. It means from, if you compare these two type of payments, the rigid payments, they certainly score a lot of points over the flexible payments. But then the question again is that why this disparity, 98.2%, why we have not been constructing these cement concrete payments in the past? So this is another, you can say, pictorial representation of these two types of payments, flexible payment and the rigid payment. So, coming to the point of that, what are the new road construction technologies which we, you can say, are adopting since last, let us say, a few years, or 1.5 decade. So the why there is need for development of new construction technology for roads. So we need to have these to have economy, first of all, number two, durability. Number three, environmental protection. Now, environmental protection is something which has come into picture during last 15-20 years. In case of every civil engineering project, we have been talking about how much is the environmental impact assessment, or EIA report is to be submitted for all kinds of civil engineering projects. So this road construction is no different from that. And conservation of natural resources, as you know, as you can see from the previous cross sections, the payments, the both types of payments, they consume a lot of natural resources in the form of stone aggregate, then bitumen in case of bituminous roads, or cement in case of concrete roads. So a lot of natural resources are used into that. And we want to minimize that. And therefore, to achieve the overall sustainable development for our future generations. So how these new technologies come into picture? So how it can be, you can say, implemented? So these new technologies can be implemented in terms of smart construction techniques. We can change the way we construct our roads. Then modern machinery, so that has been incorporated. And with modern machinery, the time taken to construct a particular stretch of the road, that has decreased tremendously. And also the quality has increased. As the construction has become more mechanized, the quality of construction has further got improved. Then use of smart materials. Okay, smart materials, those materials which may otherwise be economical in cost, but also their effect and impact on the construction or the durability of a particular structure, that will be enormous. And then the enhanced design methodology. We may be required to increase or enhance the way we are looking at the design of a particular structure, in this case, the roads. So, in India, specifically the India Road Congress, they have been specifically doing this job of enhancing or improving the design methodologies since last about 25-30 years. So, which is manifested from their frequent release of the design codes for design of flexible payment, which is IRC 37, and the design of rigid payment, which is IRC 58. So that is there. Now, let us segregate this discussion into the two types. One is new technologies for bituminous roads and the new technologies for the cement concrete roads. So starting with the new technologies for bituminous roads. The first one is reclaimed asphalt pavement. I think probably in one of the previous lecture, some speaker might have spoken on to this aspect, but anyhow. So this is the reclaimed asphalt pavement. Now this is very, very important. Now looking at its importance from the Indian perspective. As I mentioned, our existing 98% of the road, they are not going to stay as it is, as they were when they were newly built. So they are deteriorating. Okay. So when we have to replace them, when they have outlived their life, what to do with existing pavement? That is going to be a big question from the environmental point of view. Should we dig it up, the bituminous part, and throw it away and replace it with a new one? So that is going to create a lot of dumping problem. Okay. So that is why it has been thought that why not to make reuse of the existing pavement. So see, reclaimed asphalt pavement is one such technology where some part of the existing bituminous pavement is reused in the new construction. So this is reclaimed asphalt pavement. One thing I would like to make clear over here, that the term asphalt or bitumen, they are interchangeable terms. So at certain points, I will be mentioning it as asphalt. At another point, it is bitumen. Because in our country, we call it as bitumen, whereas in the Western world, in the US specifically, they call the bitumen as asphalt. Okay. So otherwise, the meaning is the same. It's a binder. It is a material which is used to bind the aggregate together. So what is RAP? So RAP is removed and reprocessed deteriorated bituminous pavement materials. Recycling of bituminous pavement. Now, recycling is something which we advocate in every case. So here also, the recycling is reusing the same material again. So recycling is defined as reuse, usually after some processing of material that already has served its first intended purpose. So the direct bituminous pavement which has outlived its life, whether it can be reused, the answer is yes. So it can be reused through RAP. The bituminous pavement rehabilitation alternatives are mainly overlays, recycling, and reconstruction. It can be used for laying the overlays, for recycling through milling, and also the reconstructing the existing pavement. So in the recycling process, the material from deteriorated pavement is known as the RAP, and which can be partially or fully reused in the fresh construction. Now, depending upon the quality of RAP, it can be used partially or it can be used you can say fully in the new construction. So there have been field studies whereby up to 95% of the existing these asphalt pavement that has been reused for the new construction. So this is excellent way of strengthening and upgradation of the deteriorated pavements. That the pavements are always getting deteriorated through the traffic loading, through the environmental conditions like temperature changes, rainfall, and all that. So they're continually changing. So at least if not for the totally new construction, at least in order to strengthen the existing pavement, this RAP can be utilized. So the recycling may be used to overcome problem of depleting natural sources, unwanted increase of road elevation. So again, very important issue. Now in the urban areas, urban roads, if you keep on overlaying them with the overlays and overlays, what will happen that the level of the road that will increase. And thereby, the level difference between these nearby property and the road level, that is going to get less and less, which can be a lot of problematic, specifically during the rainy season when the road gets flood. So if the level difference gets reduced, then the water starts entering into the properties, which cause a lot of, you can say, problem to the inhabitants. So that is why through this RAP process or the recycling process, the level of the road can be kept the same, because we are milling or we are taking out the existing pavement and reusing it with the new material and placing it at the same location. So that is very useful for city roads or urban applications. Even the Indian Road Congress have introduced this in 2015, the recommended practice for recycling of bituminous pavements. So before that, we were relying upon the ASTM standards or the standards from the other countries. But since 2015, this code has come out and it is published by Indian Road Congress, and this gives us what is the Indian recommended practice for recycling of the bituminous pavement and how it is to be used. Then also the guidelines of use for reclaimed asphalt pavement are given in this very popular IRC 37-2018 code. So this is a code for the design of flexible pavements, and in this there is a chapter on how this RAP can be utilized for the reconstruction of the existing pavement. Okay, so this can be very, very good technology for construction, road construction. This is a schematic, you can see a diagram of how this recycled bromous mix is produced. On the left hand side, you can see we have got the reclaimed asphalt material and reclaimed aggregate. It reclaimed means this asphalt and aggregate have been previously used. So they are warmed, which we call as they are warmed and taken out. That is called the process of milling. So we mill the existing this bituminous mix comprising of bitumen and aggregate, and then we add some new aggregate and a new binder to that, not in the same quantity but in the lesser quantity, and then some recycling agent is added to that, and thereby getting to what is called a recycled mix. Now recycled mix has got the properties nothing less than a new mix, so that is why they have been you can say very useful in laying these recycled mixes in our country. Okay, so it means a lot of economy is achieved in this, because we have you can say used the existing material, so thereby lesser cost of material used, and also it will be helping from the on the environmental front as well. Now this is detailed construction process and how it takes place in the field. Now this diagram shows that the whole process takes place in the field itself. It is not that we have to first of all dig out the road and then that scarified material is to be dumped over some place and then taken to the these mix you can say mix plants and their processing is done. No, even the mix plant that comes to the site itself. Okay, whereas as the existing payment that is getting milled and that material is being taken out and the new one is getting mixed in lesser quantities and then relayed, then compacted and then rolled. So this is a process which continues in the field itself. Now otherwise it can also be done that the scarified materials can be taken to the bituminous mix plant. Nowadays we have got mobile bituminous mix plant, hot mix plants, where it can be used and new material can be obtained and then brought to the site, laid and compacted. So that can also be done. So this is a the RAB construction process. Second is the plastic waste in bituminous mixes. Now, plastic waste, huge waste. So that is a big, big problem. And some of the speakers before me have might have talked about this thing, that plastic waste is a huge waste. And nowadays, many of the FTPs, they cover this aspect, that how to make use of the plastic waste. Even we have been talking about the plastic roads. And this plastic road, in fact, is not a very correct term to use, because no such road exists anywhere in the world where the everything is made up of plastic. But thing is that yes, the plastic waste can be utilized in the bituminous roads in a big way. And how it is used? This waste plastic is shredded. Shredded means it's a broken or not exactly broken, but cut into small pieces. Then it is heated and coated over aggregates. So the bituminous mix is mainly comprising of which two main material? Coarse aggregate and the bitumen. So in the conventional mixing, the coarse aggregate and bitumen, they are heated separately and they are mixed together and then heated again together before they are taken to the site and laid and compacted. But what is done with the plastic waste is the aggregate. The aggregate is mixed with the shredded waste plastic. Of course, it is properly cleaned and all that. The aggregates are heated, then it's mixed with the shredded waste plastic. Now waste plastic, when it is heated, say in up to a temperature in excess of 120 degrees Celsius, so what will happen? It will melt. Now once that waste plastic melts, then it gives a coating of that say melt plastic over the aggregate. It was a coating. Then that coated aggregate, which has been coated with the waste plastic, that is mixed with the hot bitumen, and the resultant mix is used for pavement construction. In the conventional type, where the no waste plastic is used, there the aggregate is coated with the layer of bitumen only. Now here is additional layer of the waste plastic which is coming over the aggregate. Now it has been found that the bonding, because of this, that is much greater in comparison to the conventional mix, because now we are having the additional layer, coating layer over the aggregate. First layer is with the molten plastic, and second layer is that of the hot bitumen. So So now this results into having the lesser stripping of the bitumen from the aggregate. Now this not only strengthens the pavement but also the increased durability. So its durability badh jati hai. Durability kyun badh jati hai? Because now the it will be very difficult segregate the aggregate and bitumen separately. Otherwise, what happens that as soon as the water comes in contact with the bituminous pavement, the thin layer of bitumen starts peeling off from the aggregate, and thereby leading to small pothole in the road. And if that small pothole not taken care of well in time, then it leads to bigger potholes. Okay, so every pothole starts from a loosening up of a single aggregate and coming out. So that happens because somehow the mix or the bonding between the aggregate and the bitumen that has gone away, or the stripping of the bitumen has taken place. Now, but in India, the use of waste plastic for road construction is still in its initial stage. Still, the MOTH, which is Ministry of Road Transport and Highway, National Highway Authority of India, and National Rural Road Development Agency, and different state governments have taken steps toward implementation of this technology. Now, if not in high category of roads like national highways, expressways, state highways, but at least in rural roads, under the new technology initiative of the government of India, in Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, several such projects have been constructed in our country where this waste plastic has been used in the bituminous mixes. Even the IRC has published a code, which is this IRC SP stands for Special Publication, in 2013, which gives us the guidelines for the use of waste plastic in hot bituminous mixes. It's a very good publication. And if we are following this publication, then we get the exact methodology of how this waste plastic can be used in the bituminous mixes, and thereby not only controlling or contributing to a big environmental problem, but also getting our bituminous mix, the quality of mix is going to be much better than the conventional mix. So this is another presentation or of this the whole process. In the first, the plastic waste is collected and segregated, then cleaning and drying of plastic waste, and then shredding. Then from shredding, the stone aggregate, they are heated. Then the shredded, this plastic waste is added to that. Then the coated aggregate is mixed with the hot bitumen, and then whole mix is made and taken to the site, and where it is laid and compacted. So in this process, this whole plastic coated, bitumen road, that comes into picture. So sometimes it is, since plastic is basically polymer, so many times you also call it as the polymer coated bitumen road or polymer coated bituminous mix. Okay. Then we come to the next technology, which is the cold mix technology. Now, up till now we have been talking about the hot mix technology, that the aggregate and bitumen, they are mixed together in the hot condition. Now what about cold mix technology, or what are the disadvantages of having this hot mix technology? Now let us find answers to these queries. Now this cold mix technology, though if we just listen about it, then we start thinking that how you are going to get a bituminous mix with cold mixing. Okay, because the bitumen becomes workable only when it is heated. How to mix it in the cold state? So that is a natural question which should arise in everybody's mind. But let's see how it is. Now, it is a recent technology which is gaining popularity in road construction industry all over the world. In India, this hot mix of bitumen aggregate has been used as pavement mix technology since decades. So this technology, this hot mix technology, is being used ever since this bituminous paving has come into picture. So 120 years, it is happening. But what happens with this hot mix technology is, the wide use of hot mix technology leads to environmental pollution. And these plants emit a huge amount of greenhouse gases. Yes, it is very true. Because while you are heating the bitumen separately, you are heating the aggregate separately, a lot of fuel is wasted, or fuel is burnt, and also the fumes which are coming out of that heating process, they are emitting a lot of greenhouse gases, very dangerous for the environment. And moreover, these plants are sometimes purely non-functional at the time of rainy season. Another issue, these hot mix plants, rainy season mein wo kaam nahi karte hain, function nahi karte hain because of the obvious reasons. So it means that what to do? These hot mix plants, they are problematic from the environmental point of view, and also they are not working during the rainy season. So where is the answer? The answer lies in the cold mix technology. Okay, how do we do that? The cold mix, on the other hand, is a pavement technology without heating the aggregate using bitumen emulsion. So in this case, we are neither heating the aggregate nor heating the bitumen. So what we are using? We are using the bitumen emulsion. So what is a bitumen emulsion? So bitumen emulsion is the suspension of very, very finely divided globules of bitumen in an aqueous medium, which we call, aqueous medium is water. So pani ke andar bitumen jo hai wo dissolve nahi hota hai. Bitumen doesn't dissolve in water, but it can, the small globules of bitumen can be suspended in water. So water just act as a medium for the suspension of the very small size bitumen globules. So this use of cold mix bitumen emulsion is a sustainable technology and ideal for India, as use of this negates the heating of the aggregate and binder. So this is very good plus point of this technology, that no heating is involved. So what are the advantages? No need to maintain high temperature while manufacturing and laying the mix, pollution free environment, low risk for the laborers, as nothing is you can say getting heated, or the working conditions are not very extreme as in case of hot mix plant, and favorable to work in all different weather conditions. Now the hot mix plant mix cannot be used during rainy season. It is raining, so we cannot say construct our roads because of the obvious reasons. But this cold mix technology, even you can continue laying your road even during the rainy period. So energy saving, as no heating is required, ideal for remote location and rural areas. So this technology is being tested first of all at those locations where otherwise it is very difficult to say take the material and the machinery of the conventional mix plant. So there, at the remote location or far flung rural area, this cold mix technology is being used, and the results have been very, very encouraging. And of course, if not for new construction, at least for say maintenance of the existing roads, this cold mix technology is working wonders. So not to be left behind, the IFC has also published a special publication in 2014 for the use of cold mix technology in construction and maintenance of roads using bitumen emulsion. So the key element over here is the bitumen emulsion. So the bitumen emulsion that is used in the cold mix technology instead of the heated bitumen to get the bituminous mix. Now see, if any of the participants want to stop and ask me some query in between, that is most welcome. Anybody having any query so far? Sorry?
Anyone, participants, anyone have any question?
Okay, in case there is no query, let us continue.
Okay, sir.
Okay, let us continue further. This slide shows how do we differentiate between hot mix versus the cold mix. So in the diagram above, you can see that hot mix is comprising of the aggregate, bitumen and air voids, whereas in the below diagram you can see in the cold mix you have got aggregate, bitumen, air voids and water. Now where from this water has come? The water has come from the emulsion, because emulsion, as I mentioned, that is a mix of water plus bitumen, where water is not actually mixed in bitumen is not actually mixed in water, but it is suspended in water in the finely globule forms. Okay, so this is the only difference between the hot mix and the cold mix, but the environmental implications are tremendous. Then next category, we talk about the perpetual payment. Now, what exactly we mean by the perpetual payment? If you look at the dictionary meaning of this term perpetual, that will give you that perpetual means forever. A payment which is going to last forever. Of course, practically speaking, that can never be possible. But this flexible payment having some minimum strength are not likely to exhibit structural drain damage, even when subjected to very high traffic flows over a long period of time. So with the changes in the design methodology, we have been able to achieve such type of payments, which do not get damaged even for a long period of time. So that is why this term perpetual payment has come into picture. So this is a term used to describe a long lasting structural design, construction and maintenance concept for payment. Long lasting. Now, next question is, how much long lasting? A perpetual payment can last 50 years or more if properly maintained and rehabilitated from time to time. So it means 50 years. So far, the flexible payments, we have been talking about the design period to be around 10 years or 15 years, not more than that. But here we are talking about the perpetual payment who can last even for even 50 years or more. Now, mind you, this is a flexible payment. We're talking about not the, we have not say considered our rigid payments, which are otherwise considered to be very long lasting ones. So the perpetual payments offer the following advantages. The structure, the payment structure lasts 50 plus years, indefinite fatigue life. It's very, very important. Usually the payments, they deteriorate because of the fatigue. Fatigue is the continuous cycles of loading, unloading. So that results into the fatigue to the payment structure. Then renewable payment surface, the payment surface is such that it can be renewed. High rutting resistance. Rutting is a kind of distress to the payment which occurs in the wheel path of the vehicles. So the whole of the payment width is not used by the vehicles, but those, you can, sections of the width of the road which are used by the all the vehicles most of the times, so they get depressed more in comparison to the other you can say width of the road. So that leads to depressions in the road, in the wheel path, which you call as rutting. But this perpetual payment, this gives us a very high rutting resistance, thereby not allowing this rutting distress to come into picture. Then very consistent. Consistent means no undulations are present. Then smooth and safe driving surface is available in case of this perpetual payment. It is more environmental friendly because you have put your material once and you're not time and again making use of these scarce material or the natural materials in the form of the stones and bitumen. And that's why you can say it's more environmental friendly and also avoids costly reconstruction. But in the normal type of flexible payments, the reconstruction is imminent after say 15 years or at the most 20 years. So you have to reconstruct it, you have to widen it, you have to strengthen it in order to take care of the increased traffic. Because traffic never remains the same. The traffic always keep on changing or increasing. So that is why we are in the continuous need of expanding, widening and strengthening of our existing road network. So this perpetual payment, if it is designed properly right in the beginning, keeping in view how much traffic is expected over the say next 40, 50 years. So then naturally it can result into the avoidance of the reconstruction of the payment, because reconstruction of the payment is very, very costly. As per some estimates, 1 kilometer of national highways in our country, that cost around say 20 crores of rupees at present. That is huge, huge cost. So that payment needs to be avoided from reconstruction if that cost is to be avoided. So this perpetual payment can be an answer. Now this figure shows the typical cross section of a perpetual payment. Now since this concept is not presently available in our country, so this concept is there in US presently available. So that is why you can see that these most of the units, they are in inches, the depth units, they are in inches. So the wheel load and you can see the typical depth and the material. At the top is high quality HMA. HMA stand for this hot mix ash fault. Then SMA, stone mix, stone matrix ash fault, and OGFC. So we'll be talking about these three materials separately, HMA, SMA, and OGFC, which are very, very good, high quality materials. And about 1.5 to 3 inches of that is placed at the top. Then the bottom layer is the high modulus rut resistance, this hot mix ash fault that is placed in position. And below that, you have got the fatigue resistant HMA. Because the two problems which usually we perceive in case of this flexible pavement is the rutting and fatigue. Now, when we are addressing these phenomena of fatigue and this fatigue and rutting in the pavements, naturally it is going to last long. So this fatigue resistant HMA and high modulus rut resistant HMA, they will remain in position, and this the top layer that can be recycled, or you can say reapplied from time to time as and when it is required. Then the three things which we have used in the surface layer or the top layer, that is HMA, SMA, OGFC. Let us discuss these three separately, because these are new technology things. The HMA, in fact, is the here is the, you can say, difference between the hot mix HMA and the stone mix ash fault. So let me first explain this, what is SMA. The SMA is a tough, stable, rut-resistant mix that relies on the stone-on-stone contact to provide strength and rich mortar binder to provide durability. Now, here is the difference between the conventional. On the right-hand side, it is conventional hot mix ash fault. This is something similar to which we call as a bituminous concrete in our country, or we call it as BC, or a bituminous concrete. Okay, so the American people, they call it as HMA. So this is very, very dense. Whereas on the left-hand side, you can see that this is a stone matrix ash fault. So in case of HMA, the denseness of this mix, that gives it this strength. Whereas in case of SMA, the stone to stone contact, that gives it its strength. So in a conventional dense graded mix, coarse aggregate particles, coarse means which are retained on 4.75 mm sieve, are separated by fine aggregate, which primarily carries the load. But in case of SMA, the coarse aggregate particles have stone to stone contact, forming a stone skeleton which carries the load. Now, this SMA, it has got very high bitumen content of the order of 6 to 7%. Otherwise, for bituminous concrete and all that, the maximum bitumen content is 4.5 to 5%. But this SMA has got a larger bitumen content. Therefore, when it is, this mix is getting transported from the mix plant to the site, there is every possibility that these bitumen can drain down. So in order to avoid that, a cellulose fiber is added into the mix to stabilize it, so that this draining down of bitumen that gets reduced. And the whole mix reaches to the site in the same stage as it is available in the hot mix plant. Although the cost of SMA is typically about 25 to 30% higher than the cost of dense graded bituminous mix, it's still economical considering life cycle cost. Now, since we are talking about life cycle cost, this is another concept which has come into picture. The life cycle means that it is not only the initial cost of construction which matters, but the later on cost of maintenance of that road that also matters. So it has been found that in many cases, in order to say take the full serviceable life of the pavement, the maintenance cost sometimes far exceeds its initial construction cost, so thereby enhancing the life cycle cost many folds. So that is to be avoided. But here, in case of this SMA which we are using for perpetual payments, since the life we are expecting is around 50 years, so it means that is not going to happen. So life cycle cost is going to get very much reduced, even if the initial cost of construction is very high. It means the maintenance cost will be far less. So SMA must be used in India for heavy corridors, especially where overloading is also common. Now, in the context of our country, we do not have major checks on the overloading of the vehicles, and the roads get deteriorated because of this overloading. And that is why we call the road a very, very complex structure to design. In case of buildings, you have got pre-calculated or well-calculated loads. What are the loads which are principally coming onto the road? And then you also provide a factor of safety by designing the building. But in case of road, you never know when what kind of overloaded vehicle can come and move onto the road which you have designed. That can damage the whole road. It means there is always a surprise factor with regard to this design of the pavement, that what if very, very extremely heavily overloaded vehicle comes onto your road and thereby it can damage it like anything. Because there are no, you can say, checks provided on the overloading of the vehicles at most of the locations in our country. Nowadays, of course, since some of the roads have been, you can say, provided with these toll plazas, where this facility of checking the loading of the vehicle is also there, but most of the time it has been found they are non-functional. Okay, then in India, IFC has also published a specification for use of the stone matic asphalt in our country. So that SMA can be utilized in place of this hot matrix asphalt or bituminous concrete to achieve far better quality of the surface course. And this is the third thing which we provide in case of perpetual pavement as a surface course. This is open graded asphalt friction course, OGFC. So this OGFC is an open graded hot mix asphalt mixer with interconnected voids that provide improved surface drainage during rainfall. This is the beauty of this course, that this is self-draining type. I will show you a diagram also. So the rainwater drains vertically through the OGFC to an impermeable underlying bituminous layer and then the exposed edge of OGFC onward to the shoulder. So it means it is kind of a draining kind of a surface course, which does not permit the water to stand over there. So in order to minimize hydroplaning, the hydroplaning is a phenomena whereby if the water is standing on the top of the surface and the vehicles are moving at some speed, it means the tires of the vehicles are not directly in touch with the road surface. So there is a thin film of water present between the tire of the automobile and the road surface, which is called the hydroplaning. Now this hydroplaning, if the vehicles are moving at a high speed, can cause the drivers losing, you can see, control over the vehicles because of this, and the vehicles getting skidding and slipping onto the road, which is a very, very dangerous situation for the road. So that is why in the subject which you might have studied of transportation engineering one, we study this, that why do you provide the camber onto the road? The camber is provided to drain off the rainwater so that to allow the pavement to become dry as soon as possible, because it is very dangerous to drive on the wet pavements. Okay, but here in this case, the OGFC offers that it does not allow the water to stand at all onto the pavement, because the water immediately gets drained off through the pavement itself, because it's an open graded course. Now it offers some the advantages, like reduce vehicle splash and spray behind vehicles. Take a vehicle, since there is no water, so no splash will be there, and there won't be any water spray for the vehicles coming behind. Then the tire pavement noise also get reduced. So this is this noise is another very, you can say, environmental problem, the traffic noise, right? Traffic noise generated by not the honking of the horns, but the traffic noise generated by so many number of the vehicles moving onto the road. Simply, they are the road surface and tire interaction, the noise produced because of the interaction of the road surface and their tire. Enhanced visibility of the pavement marking. So the pavement marking, different types of pavement marking which we have got on the road, they are better visible. And the nighttime, the surface glare, that also gets reduced, mainly in wet weather, because the pavement doesn't have the puddles of water onto it. Okay, so because of that reason, so this provides us a very, very good option. Now let us see the pictorial diagram of this thing. This is open graded friction course. On the left hand side, you can see the difference between what do we mean by dense graded, a gap graded, and open graded kind of a mix. The dense graded, all sizes of aggregate are available. In the gap graded, the some sizes of the aggregate they are missing. So there is gap in the sizes. And the open aggregated is one where the larger size aggregate are available, but the fine aggregates are less available. So that is open graded. And this non-availability of the fine grade, that allows the water to penetrate through the open graded mix. Even in our country, on the rural roads mainly, we are making use of what we call as the OGPC, that is open graded premix carpet. Now, depending upon whether you are applying that on the high rainfall area or the medium rainfall area, the OGPC is overlaid with a layer, not a layer exactly, but the coat called the seal coat. Whereas if it is being provided in the, you can say, lesser rainfall area, the seal coat is omitted. Seal coat is not required to be provided because not much rainfall is there. So on the right hand side, you can see this concept of OGFC. So the rainfall, even the crossfall is also there. Crossfall here means the camber. Okay. So then, as you can see that the water is percolating through the pavement. Some part of it goes alongside the camber or the crossfall. Another, you can say, portion of the rainwater that percolates through the surface and goes down. And at some point of time, the water is collected over the impervious this bituminous layer, and then it is taken to the drains. So it means the top of the pavement remains dry all the times. No, you can say stagnation of water is there. Okay. Next, we come to the warm mix asphalt. So all kinds of permutation combination we are making. First, I add the hot mix asphalt, then the cold mix asphalt. Now, what is this warm mix asphalt? So warm obviously is something in between the hot and cold. So again, a warm mix asphalt is again a fast emerging new technology which has the potential of revolutionizing the production of the asphalt mixture. So this WMA, as it is called, it was initiated in Europe in the late 1990s, primarily in response to the need for greenhouse gas reduction under Kyoto Protocol. Now this is a very, very important statement. Many of you might have studied what this Kyoto Protocol is all about, because that was the time when the concern was first raised about the presence of these greenhouse gases. And the road construction was considered to be one of the primary, you can say, culprit to emit the greenhouse gases. And because the aggregate and bitumen, they are to be heated at such a high temperature that they are emitting a lot of gases. So in response to that Kyoto Protocol, it was thought that is it possible that we should not be heating the bitumen and aggregate to such a high temperature, whether the lesser temperature can do or not. And then as a result, this technology that was developed. So this WMA technology allows the mixing, laying down and compaction of asphalt mixes at significantly lower temperature compared to the hot mix asphalt. This technology can reduce production temperature by as much as 30%. So 30% tak jo hai uske jo production temperatures hain, that can be reduced. So asphalt mixes generally produced at 150 degrees C or greater, roughly 160, 170 degrees Celsius tak usko garam kiya jata hai aggregate or bitumen ko. So depending upon what type of aggregate or binder you are using. So with 30% reduction, you can see that it will come down to 105 or at the most 110 degrees Celsius. So huge reduction in the temperature at which the mixing is taking place. So WMA is a wide range of production temperature ranging from slightly over 100 degrees Celsius to about 20 to 30 degrees Celsius below typical HMA temperatures. So as I mentioned that around 100-110 degrees Celsius is the optimum temperature at which this mixing can take place. So that is a huge climb down from the temperatures like 150-160 degrees Celsius. So that reduction in temperature has given this name as warm mix asphalt. So 100 degrees is still not warm. It will still be hot, but since it is lesser hot. Okay, just to give a name to that, the one which is getting heated at around 150 degrees plus, that is hot mix, and one where is no heating is involved, that is cold mix, and somewhere in between 110 degrees Celsius, we call it as a warm mix asphalt. So the WMA technologies are also applicable to mixes made with the polymer modified asphalt binders. So in our country, we call it as the modified bitumen, polymer modified bitumen, PMB. Okay. So this WMA technology is also workable with modified bitumens as well. So then this technology is further classified as those that use water, then those that use some type of organic additive wax, some chemical additive or surfactant. So different types of, you can say, the sub technologies are available for WMA. And of course, given the paucity of time, we can skip this for the time being. Then these are some of the advantages of warm mixtures for energy saving, because temperature more or less decreased emission. The Kyoto Protocol ka objective tha, that has been achieved with this. The emissions have got decreased. Fumes and odors, they have got decreased. And also the decreased bind rating. This is the maximum benefit. It has been found that the more you heat the bitumen, and then when you place it, then it gets oxidized at a early stage. But if you are placing the bitumen with the lesser temperature, its rate of oxidation also get reduced with use. Okay, so that is why, because of this thing, if you can see the last line which I underlined, this may enhance the fault payment durability. So if the payment, the bitumen is not getting oxidized at a shorter period of time, it means this can lead to increase in the durability of the flexible payment. So then another, you can say, nanotechnology road construction. Again, very interesting type of technology. It's a modern technique to reduce the water susceptibility and enhance the anti-slipping properties. Because we understand that the major problem with the flexible pavement is the stripping of the bitumen from the aggregate. So when the bitumen gets stripped, the aggregate gets exposed, and then that is the time it starts coming out of the pavement, leading to the pothole formation. But with this nanotechnology, it provides innovative bitumen additives. So some kind of nano additives are added to the bitumen. One example I have mentioned, this is silicon dioxide nanoparticles that chemically enhance the bond between the asphalt binder and the aggregate while reducing the water susceptibility of bituminous mixes. So you might be knowing that when we say are talking about the nanotechnology, we are talking about the nanoparticles of the size of the order of 10 raised to power minus 9 meter to 10 raised to power minus 7 meters. 10 raised to power minus 9 meter is 1 nanometer, and 10 raised to power minus 7 meter is 100 nanometers. So the particle size range varies between this. So, I mean, this is nanotechnology is very, very useful from the viewpoint of getting the better quality of bitumen, which will be having better bond, not only the aggregate to aggregate bonding, but also the layer to layer bonding. So even in if you can have a look at the last line on this slide, it is mentioned that even the Indian standards IS 1492, the anti-slipping agent for bitumen addition specification. So in this, the some guidelines about use of the nanomaterial is given for bituminous application. So which can be used for its road construction purposes. Okay, so one very good advantage of this type of using nanotechnology is that quite often we see in summer that when it is very hot, then the bitumen oozes out and come onto the top surface, and while the vehicles are moving onto the road, and you can see the imprints of the tires on the road surface. And it also happens that some loose bitumen in the molten stage get picked up by the tires of the automobiles. But if we are using this say nanoparticle in this mix, so that sort of condition doesn't happen. So therefore, there is a lot of reduction in the wastage of binder by tire pickup, which gets stuck to the wheels of the automobile during the hot summer days. So that is very good advantage. Okay, so this was these were the technologies which we have been using worldwide for the purpose of enhancing the application of the bituminous roads. Now we come to the second category, that is for the cement concrete roads. So this is the slide which I was mentioning that why earlier these cement concrete roads were not very popular. So this is answer to that, because initially the cost was very high, and the high degree of care in design and construction, non-availability of construction equipment, technical expertise. So that is why the concrete roads were not preferred over bitumen roads in the recent past. But now, when nothing of this is a problem, major road projects are being implemented using modern equipment that is available. And there has been substantial confidence and capacity building means more expertise, more know-how is available among the engineers and contractors. So the concrete roads are coming up in a big way. Now, concrete roads are different from the bituminous pavement in many ways. So the advantages are longer life, less maintenance requirement, good riding quality, skid resistance is better, lower life cycle cost, rainwater doesn't affect it, spillage of oil doesn't affect it, light reflectivity is also better, and also this leads to saving in fuel consumption. So many advantages is offered. But still that the figure haunts us, that why only 2% of the cement concrete we are having in our country, despite having so many you can say advantages. But the answer lies over here, which I have just mentioned, that we didn't have the equipment, the know-how, the technicalities for use of constructing the cement concrete roads in our country. So that is the major reason that they were not preferred. But now the scene is fast changing. And we are making use of the cement concrete roads in a big way. Now, what are the technologies which have, say, come into picture in the concrete roads? The first one is high volume fly ash concrete pavements. So you might be knowing about the utilization of the fly ash in cement, making the PPC or the Portland pozzolana cement. So about 25-30% of the replacement can be done to achieve that PPC. The results have been very good, and there has not been major problem with the strength and all that. Okay. And what we get the concrete which is having very good properties, not initially, but when it is the hardened, it's fully hardened, then it achieve almost the same strength as with the ordinary Portland cement. So this high volume fly ash concrete is a step ahead of that. Now, in this case, the replacement of this, you can say the cement content, that can be about 50%. Okay, so that is huge. And this initial cost of HVFC road is 15-20% lower than the normal concrete road, and 5-10% more than the cost of bituminous pavement. So it means there can be considerable saving if you are using this high volume fly ash concrete for pavement purposes. Now, the conventional concrete pavements, they are not, they are only PCC pavements, plain cement concrete pavements. No reinforcement is used over there. It means that we can make use of fly ash to a larger extent if it is only a pavement application. So that is why this high volume fly ash concrete pavement, they have come into picture, and they have been constructed in some parts of the country on a trial basis, and the results have been quite encouraging. And moreover, this suits to our country very well. As you can see in the last line of this particular slide, it can be used successfully in our country with very low life cycle cost and good performance, because fly ash is abundantly available and temperature is also conducive for better reactivity of the fly ash as compared to the countries like Canada and US, where the cold climate is prevailing for most of the year. So it is more suitable to our country. And the key thing is that as you can see the last line over here, in this type of rate, about 40-60% of the Portland cement is replaced by suitable quantity of fly ash. So this is a huge replacement of the Portland cement, and thus saving the cement. So thereby reducing the overall cost of the pavement. So that is HVFAC road for you. Then come the steel fiber reinforced concrete pavement. Now, again, this type of concrete pavements are being talked about. The reason being, for example, if we consider our country, in our country, the minimum grade of concrete which is to be used for the construction of highways, for national highways, state highways, that is M40. Now, this is double the grade which we can use for buildings, which is only M20 for RCC. But for cement concrete pavement, the minimum grade is M40, which is quite a rich grade. So it means this will be having a lot of cement content into that, and the grade being very rich, so its cost will also be more. The reason being because these concrete pavement, they are designed on the basis of their flexural strength. And the minimum required flexural strength is 4.5 MPa, and which is given by a PCC of not less than M40. So this steel fiber reinforced concrete, these have been introduced just to see that whether we can achieve that flexural strength of concrete which is required with a lesser grade of concrete. So the answer was found in making use of the steel fiber reinforced concrete. So steel fiber is nothing but the small, you can say, fibers of steel which was put at the time of mixing into the concrete. And then it is laid, and you can say the conventional system is used for say laying and then say compacting and thereafter curing. So even at this institute, we have also conducted an experimental study whereby we have found that this 4.5 MPa, because the flexural strength which is required, the minimum required strength for the concrete pavement, that was achievable with even M20 grade of concrete, with the addition of just 1% of steel fiber of weight of cement, which is otherwise prior to M40 grade of normal concrete. And similar such experiments have been conducted elsewhere as well, and the results have more or less been similar. So it means the steel fiber reinforced concrete pavement that can be of great value to the pavements if we can apply this in a big way. And the biggest advantage of using the steel fiber SFRC pavement is that because of the presence of the fibers in concrete, this doesn't allow the cracks, development of the cracks in the pavement. Even if the small cracks have appeared, very hairline cracks have appeared, because of the presence of the steel fibers, those cracks do not get widened up. So that is a, you can say, a huge bonus or a huge advantage for the cement concrete pavements if we are making use of the steel fibers in them. Then come the pervious concrete pavement. Now this is concrete pavement just very much like what we have seen in case of that OGFC, open graded coating in case of the flexible pavement, that was open graded friction course. So here in this case we are talking about the pervious concrete pavement, means concrete pavement which can permit the storm water or the rain water to quickly infiltrate to underlying reservoir. So here also the water is not stagnating onto the road, but it immediately drains down through the pavement itself. So in this, how it is achieved, this is a, this concrete, it's a mixture having no fine particles, no fine aggregates. So therefore a lot of white content is there. So here in this case of concrete, about 15-25% voids are achieved. Now, obviously we might be thinking that if the concrete is having so much of voids, what about the strength? The answer is yes, the strength gets reduced considerably for this pervious this concrete pavement. But rather than applying this concrete pavement for say the national highway or the those category of highways where the traffic loading is much, this type of concreting can be used in the parking lot, sidewalks or driveways where heavy traffic is not expected. So the pervious pavement are safer to drive as they also do not develop puddles like OGFC previously we have discussed, and there is a good surface grip to the tires of the automobiles. And the porous concrete can also be used in combination of interconnected concrete paver blocks, ICBP. Aajkal bahut istemal ho rahe hain hamare country mein bhi for very heavy wheel load pavement application, as is seen in this diagram, where you can see that this interlocked concrete block pavements, their jointing is not filled with sand, but here in this case, the jointing is filled with the pervious concrete. So the water can penetrate through those joints, then goes to the lower lying bedding course, and then there is a water collector provided. So that water collector attracts the water, and then it is drained off to a far off place. We call this as the under drain, which is provided under the pavement to drain off the water away from the pavement. So this is the typical design of a pervious pavement. As I mentioned, not to be used for those locations where heavy wheel loads are expected. Then come the precast concrete pavement. We might have heard about the precast these concrete panels for constructing the bridge deck or the main body of the bridges. But here the precast concrete pavement or the panels are being used for constructing the road itself. So this technology is being used a lot in US and some of the European countries. And this is finding favor with the road constructors in a big way because of its obvious advantages. So being in factory made, the quality of concrete is very good and the speed of construction is very fast. And also the maintenance cost is reduced to a considerable extent. So this slide gives you the advantages of making use of this precast concrete pavement. And the best part is that such a pavement can be used by vehicles the very next day after installation and no further curing of newly laid road surface necessary. Now, this is a great advantage from the conventional type, whereby the pavement after laid that has to be cured for 28 days before the vehicles can be allowed to ply over that. Okay, but in case of precast concrete pavement, since all the panels are previously precast, so therefore no further curing is required. And the road can be open to traffic as long as it is laid. So this is a diagram of this precast concrete pavement. Now this is in the longitudinal direction, whereas the panels of the precast concrete, they are laid in the transverse direction. So here you can see the expansion joints as well, because the concrete is pavement is something where the joints are imminent. The joints are provided. We cannot avoid the joints. So these panels are put side by side with the key mechanism, and then they have got holes within them. The holes are used to run the post tensioning tendons. So the post tensioning of these panels is done once all the panels have been laid to impart them with the more strength. Okay, so that is the advantage of this precast concrete pavement. I mean, this is such a technology which is going to be used in future in a big way. It's very fast, and so many other advantages are there. Then we come to the slip form concrete pavement construction. Now this is the way in which the pavement is actually constructed. The slip form in building also nowadays this is being used for multi-story buildings. So here in this case the low slump PCC is used, and it has been found that rather than making use of the very conventional type of paving, the production rate is of the order of 65 to 100 cubic meter of concrete per hour of paving. It means around 70 to 90 meters of the pavement, one lane wide, 3.75 meter wide, and about 250 mm thick can be laid in 1 hour. So around 80 meters per hour, that is a tremendous rate of laying this pavement. So it means from the equipment wise, this is a big plus, or you can say big advantage over the conventional type of pavement construction, where the rate of construction is very, very good. And also because a lot of automation and computer control is involved in the, you can say, use of the slip form concrete paver. So the riding surface obtained is very, very smooth. You can see in the last line, I mentioned IRI. IRI stands for International Roughness Index. So this international roughness index is of the order of around 0.9 meter per kilometer or even less. So it is pretty acceptable from the international criteria from the viewpoint of the smooth riding surface. Now this is this slip form paving technique which is shown in this picture. So the major advantage of this scheme is the very, very fast rate of construction. Then another, we can say, technology which is being used nowadays is the white topping of the cement concrete overlays. Now, since this is an overlay of cement concrete over the existing bituminous pavements, sometimes the existing bituminous pavement, they become, you can say, very distressed and very bad. Now they can be, you can say, rejuvenated by providing this white topping cement concrete overlays. Why white topping? Because even the cement concrete slabs, you call them as the white topping. The bituminous road, they are called the white top roads. Cement concrete road, they are called the white top roads, okay, because of their obvious colors. Though cement concrete is not exactly white, but it is grayish in color, but still, since these bituminous roads are black top and the cement concrete road, we start calling them as the white top. So this overlay is over the existing pavement, a thin, you can say, overlay of cement concrete we can provide in order to enhance the overall life of the existing pavement. So this is one example where the white topping has been done on a peripheral road in Bangalore, and the results have been very, very good. Then we have got the roller compacted concrete for pavement. So again, a different type of technology which is being used not for main highways but at least for rural roads, mainly in Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. So this is being used. So as the name indicates here, the concrete used is of zero slump concrete. So very, very stiff concrete. Okay, the concrete is very stiff. So that stiff concrete is laid in position, and then it is not, you can say, compacted with the traditional vibrators. But for this purpose, the road rollers are used, as you can see in this figure. So very stiff concrete with almost zero slump. It means water cement ratio is very much on the lower side. So the concrete is placed in position, and then it is loaded or it is compacted with the traditional rollers, which we usually see on the bituminous roads. So on the left hand side, you can see the whole methodology of this concrete pavement. And on the right hand side, you can see a picture of actual construction of this type of concrete pavement. Okay. So these are the various technologies, and I hope I have already taken too much of time. So let me now finish my presentation with some concluding remarks. All of us understand that construction of durable, economic, long life roads with low maintenance costs will be one of the top priorities for the road constructors of future. Future mein iski bahut zarurat hai ki jo bhi hum sadke banayenge वो इतने ड्यूरेबल हों, इकोनॉमिकल हों, एंड देयर लाइफ शुड बी लॉन्ग, एंड उनकी मेंटेनेंस कॉस्ट जो है वो कम होनी चाहिए. तो टू बियर द एवर इंक्रीजिंग ट्रैफिक लोड, ट्रैफिक लोड्स आर ऑलवेज इंक्रीजिंग, लाइक एज पॉपुलेशन इज इंक्रीजिंग, ट्रैफिक लोड्स आर ऑल्सो इंक्रीजिंग. सो न्यू मटीरियल्स, प्रोडक्ट्स एंड कंस्ट्रक्शन टेक्नोलॉजीज नीड टू बी डेवलप्ड एंड यूज्ड, अगेन फ्रॉम द एनवायरमेंटल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू ऑल्सो, दैट वी शुड बी मिनिमाइजिंग द यूज ऑफ नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज. It means we need to develop the new materials and products and construction technologies. In the recent times, we have witnessed development of several new pavement construction technologies, both for bituminous and cement concrete pavements. This is what I have just discussed with you. Now, these technologies have demonstrated that the construction of roads can be quicker, more stable, economical, and sustainable in the longer run in comparison to the conventional method of construction. So this we have witnessed already in case of so many technologies, that they are far, far better than the conventional ones. Although some of these new road construction technologies are not very popular at present in our country, but looking at the tremendous advantages offered by these technologies, it is hoped that very soon these shall get wider acceptance amongst all stakeholders connected with the development of road transportation sector. So, I mean, in many of the technologies, the IRC has taken a lead. They have come out with their set of these codes for making use of these payments. And in other cases, this technology is still available in the Western countries, but soon that will be imported to our country. It is hoped and utilized, looking into the such a large, you can say, volume of road being constructed in our country. So hopefully that is going to help our country in a big way for the development of the infrastructure. So these are some of the references, not all, but some of the references which I have used for the preparation of this my presentation. Thank you very much. Thanks for very patient listening to me for about hour and half. Thank you very much, participants. In case anybody is having any questions, you are most welcome to ask. Okay. Any question, please?
Participants, have you any question?
As I can see, number of participants is reducing only.
At the end of the sir, generally 62 participants are during the lecture.
Okay, okay, okay. So, any queries, participants? Okay, over to you, Kundan.
Okay, sir. I would like to thank Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Agarwal sir for taking out time from his busy schedule and enlightening us with his valuable knowledge. Thank you so much, sir. And I also thank to all participants for their presence with us. Thank you so much, sir.
Welcome. Okay.
Thank you, sir. It is very understanding presentation.
Thank you, Jagat.
Now the end of the third session of day two. Tomorrow we start our first session with Dr. Sanjeev Sharma sir, NITER from Chandigarh, on the topic of advances in green and eco materials in construction. So now we meet tomorrow from 9 a.m. or 9:30 a.m. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.